Peter Pan. New scene at end of play. Years later, Peter flies back to the nursery, still a boy, heartbroken to find Wendy grown old. Peter, really the ghost of a boy who dies in childhood. Comes back to search for his mother, finds her an old woman, doesn't recognize her. A statue of Peter Pan. Could immortalize him for generations, long after play, buried and forgotten. If I paid for it, could this be deducted from tax?
Michael? Michael? Come on, Michael, come on, wake up. Come on. The doctor will be here any minute, must get you washed and scrubbed.
It's such a funny dream, Mary. I dreamt I saw Father's ghost in the garden. But that wasn't the funny thing. The funny thing was, he wasn't a ghost at all.
I should hope not.
No, I mean, he was real, but I was the ghost. Because when he came to touch me, he went right through me and fell in a river. And I couldn't swim,
open so wide. You and your dreams. Sometimes wonder half the time whether you're awake or asleep.
Are they for me?
No talking. I'll read them to you. Oh, it's from your father. Dear Michael, I do hope the scarlet fever has fled and you will soon be up and well again. I wonder if your doctor is as kind and as good as mine. I have three pretty nurses to look after me, but you have dear Mary Hodgson, who is worth all of mine put together. I've been in hospital so long now that it almost seems like home. Mr. Barry manages to come and see me almost every single day. He's sitting with me now, reading a newspaper. Don't you think Mr. Barry is a very good friend to us all? Now, goodbye, my dear boy, and see you very soon from your affectionate father. Well, now, isn't that a nice letter? You must write back as soon as you... Michael, you haven't been listening to a word.
Yes, I have. Will you read this one?
I said no talking.
She's from Uncle Jim.
So I see. Dearest, beloved Michael, the rose is red, the violet blue, honey is sweet, so are you. J.M. Barry.
Is it normal?
Nope. Take off your nightshirt. Said take off your nightshirt.
Why do I have such bad dreams, Mary?
I don't know, to be sure. I've never had a bad dream in my life, except when I've had to do your mending.
Uncle Jim has nightmares.
I dare say he does. I wouldn't be surprised if he wasn't to blame for some of yours, too.
Why? Mary.
Why ask me? You know him far better than I do. Oh, just look at the state of your neck. I think I only washed it a few hours ago.
Can I write back to him?
You shall write to your father first. After that, you can write to whoever you like.
It's only the Peter Pan chapters reprinted from The Little White Bird. I think Arthur Rackham's illustrations are rather fine, don't you?
Ah, superb. Oh. When do I get my copy?
You'll have to wait until Christmas.
Oh.
This is an advanced copy from the publishers. It only arrived this morning.
Oh, for your wedding anniversary. What a kind thought of Jimmy's.
Yes. Yes, wasn't it? But then Jim's always known how to spoil me.
Thank you.
Tremendous loss on Napoleonic.
Mrs. Rowan here.
Yes, sir.
Napoleon and Josephine. Well, we opened Napoleon and Josephine in Omaha on a Monday. I called it a tragedy. On Tuesday, I called it a comedy. On Wednesday, I called it off. The moral of the story is there's no such thing as bad towns, only bad plays. Now, isn't that right, Jimmy?
Oh, that's the rule of the American theater. An audience is never wrong. When you put on Romeo and Juliet in the Bronx, they cried out for author, not wishing to disappoint so discerning an audience. Charles, in his modesty, stepped forward and took the bow.
You didn't.
Whereupon they showered me with rotten matzo balls.
I remember once when I was an actress, I was playing Rosalind in As You Like It, and the actor playing Touchstone.
Yes, and?
Oh, doesn't matter. Wasn't a very good story anyway. Oh, look what Charles bought us for our wedding anniversary. Isn't that sweet of him?
Oh, well, they tell me that 12 years is meant to be silk and fine linen. But I see you've broken the rules, too. I trust you've dedicated the opus to her.
Opus?
Peter Pan in Kensington Gardens.
I'm showing Charles the book before you arrived.
Oh, yes, that. It's, the illustrations are rather fine. Cut above the text, anyway.
Well, I'd better be getting back to rehearsal before my cast starts rewriting your lines.
Oh, it wouldn't surprise me if they did. Actors always presume to know their parts better than they often conceive them. The fact that Shakespeare was an actor always seems to me the strongest argument in favor of Bacon having written the plays.
Well, we're seeing this evening, Charles.
Yes, I hope so. Thank you for the excellent tea.
Dinner?
I'd love to. Thank you.
Bye.
You know, you may be right, Jimmy. And I received a cable this morning from New York about Quality Street. Apparently, old Mildred Morris is demanding that her name go above the title of Maude Adams. Now, how am I to deal with such prima donna as...
Simple. Give her what she wants.
Charles Roman presents Maude Adams, but Mildred Morris, you can't sleep a day better.
Very good. Come on.
Hope I haven't left any dirty finger marks on.
No, I'll get you your present tomorrow.
Yes,
yeah, I just completely forgot.
Where's Do?
Anyway, thank you for not...
Nothing to thank me for. For my sake, not yours. I'll be leaving for Black Lake early tomorrow, so I probably won't see you before Monday. I've left all the household instructions with Mrs. Benson.
Aye.
Oh. There is one small thing you could do for me, if you really want to give me a present.
Yes?
The way you kissed me just now. The way you always kiss me. I'd be so grateful if you never did it again.
It's been my fault since the beginning. You should have married a better man than me. But can't we make a fresh start? Try and pick up the pieces? She says no. Love is not a broken jug, but spilt wine. You can't pick that up. Too late to talk of love. She no longer wants it. A revulsion when he touches her, etc. But still keeps up the pretense in front of others. Not for his sake, but a woman's vanity. In Act One, audience might think she is to be a sweet, long-suffering wife. Husband also thinks he can do without her. His success all his own making. Not until Act Three, when she leaves him, does he realize truth? Behind every man stands a woman in the shadows, mother or wife. Every woman knows this. But a man must learn it by experience.
I'm quite well, thank you. But Mary says I am not. And she says I must stay in bed for another week. And I've got an acorn, and Mr. Barry has got a cold. And he sent me another poem. And I'm very lonely, and I wish I was in hospital with you. And please come home before I'm grown too old. And now I must write to Mr. Barry from Michael. Hello, Jimmy. We've just been hearing all about you from our Berkhamsted correspondent.
Oh.
Poor Michael, he must be so lonely down there on his own. Do you think you ought to go and spend a night there, Sylvia? After all, a mother's place is with her children.
I know that, Mummy. And I intend staying here with Arthur. George? Oh, I'm afraid Michael isn't any better. I don't think he'll be able to come down to London this year for Peter Pan. He's dreadfully disappointed, but the doctor wants him to stay indoors for at least another month. George, darling.
Come on.
Hello, Uncle Compton.
Hello, George.
Hello, Father. Are you feeling any better?
Very good. Good.
The operation on the palate has helped the pain, but he won't be able to speak properly for some time. Oh. He wants to know how you're getting on with your scholarship.
Oh, well, I'm sorting like a fifth wrangler, but I'm not very hopeful. Oh, here's a present for you.
Jack.
Tell Arthur I'll be in to sit with him later.
Oh, Jimmy, are you sure it's not?
Well, you know it is. Good night.
Goodbye. Goodbye.
How big is the nursery room at Edgerton House?
I haven't the faintest idea. Why?
Roughly.
I suppose it's about the same size as your study at Leinster Corner. Why?
It's just a passing thought. It's past.
See you later. What is it?
Oh, well, it's meant to be for me, but really it's from Uncle Jim. It's a special copy before you can get any shots.
It's beautiful.
No, I don't think so. He cut all the best bits out.
Which bits?
All the bits about me and Uncle Jim.
Well, I think it's beautiful. Oh, so like Jimmy to think of it, don't you think, dearest?
Ta-da! There's none can save you now!
There's one who never fails!
Who's that?
Peter Pan, the Avenger!
Cleveland to the dust!
Spark your swords, boys! This man is mine.
So, Pan, this is all you're doing.
Aye, Jasuk, it is all my doing.
He's Napoleon!
That's who I am. I'm Napoleon. He was little too.
Proud and insolent youth! Prepare to meet thy doom!
Dark and sinister man, have at thee! Your turn, Uncle Jim. Your turn.
Wait, tis some fiend fighting me, Pan. Who or what art thou?
I'm the sun rising. I'm the poet dreaming. I'm joy, I'm youth, I'm eternal youth.
Do it again! Oh, save me, Captain! Get him! Oh, back! Back, you puling spawn! I'll show you now the road to dusty death. No words of mine can express my utter contempt for thee.
Hook! Thou not wholly unheroic figure. Farewell! Hooray! Well done, Peter! Floria Titona!
The master and his son were left alone. But the majestic river floated on. Out of the mist and hum of that lowland, into the frosty starlight. And there moved, rejoicing through the hushed Charasmian waste, under the solitary moon. Until at last, the longed-for dash of waves is heard, and wide his luminous home of waters opens, bright and tranquil, from whose floor the new-bathed stars emerge and shine upon the Aral Sea.
Thank you.
Come in. Excuse me, Mrs. Barry. There's a Mr. Gilbert Cannon called to see Mr. Barry. Very well. Will you show him in here?
Very good.
Not in.
Oh, he asked me to leave the committee's report for his inspection. I'm the committee secretary, Gilbert Cannon.
For Captain Scott?
Captain.
From the Antarctic Committee?
Oh, no, the censorship committee.
Oh. Oh, yes. You must forgive me. My husband's on so many different committees these days, I get a bit confused by it all. Unfortunately, he's gone down to Eton for the day.
Oh, you have a boy there?
No. No, just a friend of his who's sitting some sort of scholarship exam.
Oh, I see. Well, perhaps you'd be kind enough to give your husband these. He'll be needing them at dinner tonight.
Tonight?
The Home Secretary. Oh, he is having dinner with him tonight, isn't he?
Yes. It's Friday, isn't it? I was thinking it was Thursday. Yes. Yes, we are.
Well, these are the amendments he wanted in here. I've marked them in pencil. And this is the draft proposal. If there are any problems, I'll be at the Royal Court Theatre all afternoon.
Fine. I'll give them to him as soon as he gets back.
Thank you. Is this your work?
A hobby, really. Good in my spare time.
Your husband has a very talented wife, if I might say so. Well, goodbye, Mrs. Barry.
Mrs. Benson will see you out.
You know, the only time I feel a foreigner in England is when I try to understand your public school system. It just completely defeats me. Did you see George when he went in to face the examination firing squad? He had Floria Tatona written all over his smile. He's in love with the place. They haven't even let him in yet. Don't you worry about George. He'll do very nicely for himself, you see.
Don't kiss me, Mother. There's a sport. Whatever you do, don't blub. I realize I haven't cried since that day in the hospital. I broke down on your shoulder and cried like a baby. I've got no emotion left. I'm dried up, numb.
Of course you're not. Your heart beats bravely as ever.
Oh, Jimmy, for heaven's sake, stop being so sympathetic. I need you to shake me to my senses, not suffocate me with kindness. I can't laugh, I can't cry. I'm just a vegetable, and I'm vegetating in self-pity.
I remember what I told you. Oh, I don't think I did. A couple in Scotland, been married for over 40 years. And the wife died. And the husband was miserable. Distraught. And the undertaker came, and she was laid out in her coffin. Carried her downstairs along the garden path, and they were just going through the gate. The coffin struck the gatepost. Presently, I heard this knocking on the coffin lid, so they put it down and opened it up, and, well, you can imagine. husband was overjoyed to see his wife still alive. Well, they lived on happily for 4 or 5 years. Then the wife died again. Undertaker came, laid out in the coffin, carried down the stairs along the garden path. They were just going through the gate. The husband leant over to the undertaker and said, "Hey, mind that post."
Censoring plays.
The committee is for the abolition of censorship.
Well, there you are. That Mr. Cannon must have thought I was a complete idiot. Is there anything I could do?
Yes, pass the ink, will you?
The richest writer in England, and he has the blackest cups with ink.
You.
I meant, isn't there anything I could do to help with this committee work?
Yes, you can try and read this chap's writing if you like. It's worse than mine.
Would you like me to typewrite them out?
You can't typewrite.
I could learn. On the machine I gave you, you never use it.
All right, if it amuses you. I'm going to be sitting up with Arthur tonight, so don't bother to wait up.
Can I really?
Can you really what?
Typewrite these papers?
I just said you could, but I can't for the life of me think why she should want to.
They'd be of use to you. Right, darling.
Good night, dear.
For June the 16th, my Michael's 6th birthday. We shall all be coming home on Thursday, in Mr. Barry's motor car if it is fine, and I will bring my present to you then. I want so to tell you about Father, who is so brave, and you'll be so proud that you are his son. I don't like being away from you on your dear birthday, but it will not be long now. Oh, my little Michael. Won't it be fine when we're all together again? Father does so want to be back with his sons. He still cannot talk properly, and when he comes home, you'll have to try and guess what he's saying, as Mary does for Nico. Mr. Barry is here with me, and he is writing too. Don't you think he's a very good friend to all of us? He's our fairy prince. Much the best fairy prince that ever was, because he is real. I expect he's inventing some more funny stories to give you to read.
Arthur talking to me about death. Spoke about great difference in dying when you have children. You yourself living on in them. Not going out completely. Could work this into story of dying man who yearns for a second chance to live life over again. Perhaps he has no children of his own. Curse of his life could be that he's never had a woman. Blames women for this, but really his own fault. A black spot within him there since birth. It could be a play about two men, each trying to overcome some accursed thing inside them. One a physical disease, a la Arthur, the other mental, spiritual. Each tries to fight it. But it gets us both in the end.
But it's political support we really need. And I just don't see how we're going to get it.
Well, the Home Secretary assured me that if we could find enough eminent authors to support the petition, he'd be prepared to lay it before the Commons for debate. So I suggest that our next move is to draw up some kind of draft stating our case and put it out on a circular basis.
Well, the only problem there is steering a middle course. I mean, how to get the maximum amount of support without having to compromise. Granville Barker feels it.
Oh, it's 2 o'clock, Uncle Jim. Mother's waiting outside in the car.
Oh, Gilbert, this is George Llewellyn Davis.
How do you do?
How do you do?
George, this is Gilbert Callan, an author of Some Talent, unlike my good self.
Hello, George. George is the one who started it all.
Started what?
Longest story I shall never write.
His father's been in hospital, but today's the great day, isn't it?
Yes. We'll take him home in Mr. Barry's motor car.
You will give him my fondest love, won't you?
Draw up something along those
and
lines.
And to your mother.
Then we can discuss it.
Fine, fine. I'll leave it with Mary.
Fine.
Goodbye, George.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, dearest. I'll see you.
Anon.
Peter! Michael!
Father! Father!
Hello, dear boy.
Hello, Father. Where's Uncle Jim?
He'll be out in a minute. Father's got his birthday present for you.
Oh, thanks. Hello, Father. Can I show you my rats?
No, you can't. I haven't shown you my butterflies yet.
I wanted to give you a first edition with plates, but your mother stole it back to give you nightmares.
Give what?
Give you nightmares, darling.
Oh. Why?
Well, they're very... Oh, it doesn't matter now. Why don't you wheel Father round the garden?
Michael, look what Uncle James brought you. Oh, please, may I go and open it?
Well, no, darling, no. I really don't think you would.
Let him go if he wants to.
Uncle Jim!
Come on, then.
Why has he called him Uncle Jim? Oh, oh. Why not?
He's not our uncle.
Now, Jack, I think Uncle Jim knew him very well.
Now, who's going to show me around the garden?
I will first. No, we all will. Let's show him the blackcap's nest first.
No, I was first. I want to show him my rats. Look, Mother. Look what Uncle Jim's given me.
Well, that's lovely, darling.
May I put it on?
Yes, yes, of course you can. Let me go help you. Some rather bad news, I'm afraid. I haven't told Arthur yet.
What is it?
George. He's failed his scholarship to eat.
Oh, is that all? I thought it was something to do with Arthur.
Of course it's to do with Arthur. He can't possibly afford the school fees.
You're forgetting my promise.
Oh, no. No, Jimmy, no. The operations were one thing, but if you start paying for the boys as well, but I don't think Arthur could bear that.
Do you know how much money Peter Pan has made since it opened?
What's that got to do with it?
Just over £500,000. And that's not including America. Now, where would Peter Pan be without George? Don't you think he deserves his share of the spoils? Even if it is only to send him to school.
There's the others. We can't just send George to Eton. It wouldn't be fair on the others.
Oh, don't you worry. I'll get my money's worth out of them yet. You'll see.
Oh, I'm finished, man. Happy!
I don't know what we'd have done without Mr. Barry. He'd been so kind and generous.
We'd have done all right.
What was that, Jack?
Nothing, Father.
I think it was something. Peter?
Yes, Father?
Would you like to show me your rats now?
Shall I get them?
You shall. Jack? I want you to listen to me. Don't think I don't understand how you feel about Mr. Barry. No one understands him as well as I do, because it's how I felt about him myself. The only thing we ever had in common was our mutual love for you boys. And no father likes to share his children with another man. But I have heard so much from him that he's wise and good and true, that I have come to regard him as a brother. His love for you boys is my one great comfort when I think of the future after I'm gone.
But you're better. Mother said so.
There's always a chance. But
it's not true, Father.
Believe me, I'd howl if I thought there was any use. But I want you to be brave. Like I'm feebly trying to be brave. We mustn't think of ourselves.
Us boys! That's it, that's better. Look straight into the camera. Let's hear that drum beating inside of you. You stand there. You just look through this. Walk in a minute.
We, the undersigned, protest against the present censorship of plays, an office instituted for political and not the so-called moral ends to which it is perverted. An office authoritarian in procedure.
Wait. Autocratic.
Autocratic. Procedure. That's not good. Autocratic.
Yes, that's good.
Autocratic in procedure, opposed to the spirit of the Constitution and contrary to common justice and to common sense.
Oh, very good.
The lovely moment. Finest dream in the world. That it is early morning and I am out on a highland road. It is a time before I knew anything of the world and its pain and sorrow. I am a boy again. Everyone I have loved is still alive. It is the morning of my life.
The following authors have already promised their support. J.M. Barry, Harley Granville Barker, Gilbert Cannon, Joseph Conrad, Galsworthy, Thomas Hardy, Anthony Hope, Ben Hausman, James, John Masefield, A.W. Mason, W. Somerset Maugham, George Meredith.
Alfred Blaine.
Hello.
Yeah. Yesterday morning, he offered his full support.
Oh.
George Murray.
Sylvia.
Gilbert Murray. George
for you.
Shaw. Algernon Swinburne, H.G. Wells, and W.B. Yeats. We hope that you two will lend your support by signing the enclosed and returning it at once to J.M. Barry, Leinster Corner, Lancaster Gate, London West. Yours truly, etc., etc. Does that sound better to you, Jimmy?
Dearest Jimmy, I think of you so often, and I know how you loved Arthur, and that helps me in my sorrow. You will love me always, won't you, and help me live through the long, long years. How shall I do it, I wonder? It seems so impossible. We were so utterly and altogether happy, and that happiness is the most precious thing on earth. I'm so grateful to you, and I will show it one day, I hope. But just now I am full of deadly pain and sorrow, and I often wonder I'm alive. I always sleep with my George now, and it comforts more than I can say to touch him. And I feel Arthur must know. He will live again in them, and that must be my dear comfort till I go to him at last. How we long to grow old together. Oh, my dear friend, it's all so utterly impossible to understand. The boys are loving and thoughtful, but they've all got to grow up and be men and leave me. And for Arthur's sake, I must fight that fight too. I think of him almost always now, as he was before the tragic illness. God gave him the finest face in the world.
Mrs. Arthur?
Yes, I think that's right.
Oh, I sometimes wonder if those boys ever realised that the soft pedal wasn't built into the piano for nothing.
Jack, play the piano as loud as he likes. Oh, this one will be finished in a moment.
It's Mr. Crompton, Lola and Davy. Shall I show him in?
Please, Mary.
How's the move going?
Well, I think they fit in rather well, don't you?
Very attractive.
Would you like some coffee?
No, thank you. I need to stop by to see how you're settling in. I was having lunch with Brother Morris yesterday.
Ooh.
And he brought up the subject of the boy's future. Have you had any thoughts on the problem?
What problem?
Well, on how you're all going to manage.
Managing very well.
I meant financially. Five boys, quite an expense, particularly if they're going to Eton. And poor Arthur can't have left you with very much.
He left me with everything I need. Crumpton, as far as the money's concerned, Jimmy Barry has offered to pay for the boys' education.
Doesn't that rather compromise?
I don't see why. He enjoys paying for them.
Well, the suggestion is that we brothers set up a trust fund for you and the boys.
I don't see that that's necessary.
But it would make you independent.
I've always been independent. All my life.
As long as you know what you're doing. Still, if ever you find the boys becoming too much of a handful, next holidays, for instance?
That's very thoughtful of you, but... well, actually, next holidays... Well, Jimmy Barry's invited us to Switzerland.
Well, perhaps the summer, then. Do you remember their pleasure when Arthur used to take them to the theatre? Penny seats and onto the ABC for supper. Bye-bye.
Bye.
That's all right. I'll see myself out.
Gaston, what time does the afternoon post usually arrive, please?
Excusez-moi, monsieur.
Il veut savoir quelle heure arrive la poste.
Eh bien, monsieur, la poste arrive à 16h30.
Merci. He said 4:30.
Merci.
Your turn. I hope you've got enough money to pay me.
Oh, Scotsman's never short of ways of making money. I remember I once paid the boy a shilling a day to do his mourning for him. His mother had just died, and he was finding it rather uphill work to look solemn, especially as the football season had just started, so I volunteered to do his mourning for him. Remember, every day I used to swap my green jacket for his black one, and I'd go and stand in a corner of the playing field, and I'd squeeze my fist into one eye like this. The tears would come out of the other one. He ran gaily off to play football. It's your turn.
That's another 10 francs you owe me. You want another game?
Mm-hmm.
Can you afford it?
No.
I love crying. It makes me go all misty inside. But nothing much makes me cry anymore. I used to lots, but not anymore.
I bet I can make you cry.
I bet you can't.
10 francs.
Done. Am I for a story?
No, no, just a thought.
About me?
About your father?
You can't make me cry about him. I thought I would forever, but I didn't at all except for a bit. Mother still cries, though, doesn't she? Do you love her?
Of course I love her.
More than Mrs. Barry?
You shouldn't ask questions like that.
You said I could ask you anything in the world.
When was I so rash?
When we were playing the game.
I was only in the game.
Well, let's play the game now. I'm bored of winning drafts all the time. Anyway, what have you written down?
Michael said, did Father leave me anything in his will? I said, yes. Disease of the liver.
You never said that.
Well, next time.
Let's play the game. Who'd you like best?
Best of who?
Me and Nico and Peter and Jack and George.
Well,
oh, and you're not allowed to say all the same.
Jack.
Liar.
Peter.
Liar.
Well, if you know the answer, why ask the question?
I'd just like to hear you say it.
You flatter yourself, don't you?
What's the most exciting thing that's ever happened to you?
Most exciting thing that ever happened to me was something beginning with M.
Money?
Besides money.
Mother?
Warmer.
Michael! Me!
You can see the balls, even me.
But it is me, isn't it? Oh, do say it's me. I won't tell anyone.
All right. It pains me to confess it, yes. Me is the most exciting thing that ever happened to me. Not you, mind. Me.
But at least I'm the second most exciting thing, aren't I?
Oh, no. Second most exciting thing that ever happened to me was when a school friend of mine came running up to the house one day and told me that an old man who used to give us sweeties had slit his throat with a razor, and if I hurried, I'd see the blood.
Did you?
I most certainly did. It was just about the most thrilling thing I've ever seen. It was enough blood to make us black puddings for 6 months. Now it's my turn. Why don't you go skiing with the others?
To be with you. Till death us do part.
pulled out your wedding finger.
Why?
Go and blow a smoke ring on it.
But we're both boys.
You speak for yourself.
You're a boy too.
No. I'm what is commonly known as grown up.
You're not common and you're definitely not grown up. You're old, but you're not grown up. You're one of us.
How do you know?
Because I think if you were really a grown up, you wouldn't waste all your money on a boy like me.
You presume to know me very well, don't you?
Inside out. Without a doubt. Is how I see the mystery of J.M.B. Quite the coming poet, ain't I?
To be a poet is a great thing. But to be a poet and not to know it is the most glorious thing in the world. Besides, there's no money in poetry.
Maybe not. There's a lot of poetry and money.
Hello, Uncle Jim. We've had an absolutely spanking time.
I shall never be any good at it as long as I
live. My new fellow.
Gilbert the Filbert took us luge on Roche, and then we drove over to Montreux for lunch. I got a bit tipsy.
Ripped and nasty.
Where's your mother?
She's downstairs in the billiards room with the others. Come on, we're going to have a slosh tournament.
Oh, I did love all that toboggan.
No, I've still got a lot of work to do. So is Mr. Cannon.
Well, don't be long.
No.
Has there been any news?
Yes, Froman telegraphed to say the Lord Chamberlain had banned Granville Barker's plays, so we'd better draft some sort of reply.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Really?
It's just what we've been waiting for.
You better go with George. I'll be down late.
Can't I stay with you?
You'd be wasting your time. There's no money in it.
Oh,
it's so
funny.
Look at something. It's like a chest case.
What's the matter?
I don't want your money.
What's the matter with Michael?
It's the poet in him. It's just a game we play.
But why has he banned the play?
Lord knows. He doesn't have to give a reason.
The Lord Chamberlain only likes nice, comfortable plays, set in nice, comfortable homes. The moment you write about real life, he bans it.
Anything likely to corrupt or deprave or otherwise cause a breach in the preservation of good manners. In other words, anything likely to expose the hypocrisy of society. Garçon, je vous prie. De bouteille de Krug, 1902.
Oh!
I've already ordered.
I know, but this is a celebration. And it's on me this time. George. You'd like champagne, wouldn't you?
No, rather.
Me too, please.
And me.
You're going to bed as soon as you finish.
Free, get me a
bottle. No time for any puddings.
Is that the best you have?
It is a very fine champagne, monsieur.
It's not what I asked.
Naturally, it is not as good as Le Veuve Tico 92, the widow. That is the best there is. But the Krug is an excellent choice.
Oh, Michael, Nick has nearly finished his pudding.
I don't want any.
Well, look, just finish up a bit of the meat. Have you nearly finished, Peter? Because it's nearly time for me. Oh, Jimmy, please don't do that.
But I'm paying for it.
I don't care. Michael, do as you're told. Finish it up.
Alors, monsieur. Deux bouteilles de Krug.
Oui, monsieur la chambre 114.
Bien, monsieur.
Hey, waiter, will you change that to two bottles of the widow, please, and charge it to my room, as usual?
Very good, monsieur.
And Jimmy, I wanted to...
Let's just celebrate. Now, I must be wrong, but I can't believe that Mr. Barker's got anything to celebrate about if they banned his play.
He's as keen as anyone else to see an end to censorship. The play is just the means.
Just goes to show how little you understand about writers.
What? Oh, Gilbert wouldn't mind, would you, if it was your play?
Well, I suppose if it helped the cause...
Come along, Nico. Let's leave these revolutionaries to their schemes. Time for bed.
Well, why is it always me? Just because I'm the youngest?
It isn't only you. Peter, Michael, you too. Time for bed.
Jack!
Michael, stay a little longer.
No, Jimmy, it's not fair in the office. Say good night. Good night. Good night, boys.
Good night, Peter. Good night, boys. Next move.
Good night. You know, Jimmy, Sylvia's right. You really shouldn't spoil Michael so much. It's not good for him.
Since when have you been an authority in bringing up children?
Yes, I think so.
Yes, that'll do nicely, thank you.
Yeah, monsieur.
I wonder why Uncle Jim's in such a bad mood.
Come on, Nico.
He's not in a bad mood. He's just not in a good mood. That's all. Mother? What is it? Michael, help me. Quick.
Mother, are you drunk?
Oh, don't be stupid. For heaven's sake, stop it. Michael, quick, go and fetch Uncle Jim.
Oh, Peter, I'm all right. Just
go on, quickly!
It, all right. Oh, Mother. All right, all right. Just let me rest a minute. Don't leave me.
I'm still here.
I've put the boys to bed. They're fast asleep.
One of us should stay with Mother.
She'll be right. She's got Uncle Jim.
I know, but I still don't like to leave her.
The doctor's given her a sleeping draught, so let's leave her to sleep in peace.
Don't leave me. Arthur, don't leave me here without you.
Dear Sylvia, I hear from George that you're feeling a little better these days. But I don't believe it. And that saddens me more than I can say. How I wish you were all down here at Black Lake, which is where you belong. I feel the boys are all growing up without my looking on. And I grudge every blank day without them. I can't picture a summer's day that does not have Michael skipping in front of it. That is summer to me. All the five know me as nobody else does. The bland indifference with which they accept my moods and tantrums is the most engaging thing in the world to me. Be able to help you and them is my main reason for going on. And my greatest pride is that you let me do it. My censorship work continues as dreary as ever now that Froman is back in New York, but I dare say the end is in sight. Ever your loving servant, J.M.B.
Yes, come in. Oh, yes, Hunt, you wanted to see me.
That's right, sir.
What is it?
Well, sir,
It's like this, sir.
Why don't you sit down, huh?
Thank you, sir. Well, sir, I likes to take a pride in me job, same as how I expect you does, sir. What I mean is, I likes to do me best, sir.
I'm sure you do. If I had the same green fingers with my pen as you have with your flowers, I'd be a happier man.
Well, that's very kind of you, sir. You see, it seems like your wife, Mrs. Barry, that is. It seems she don't share your generous sentiments, sir. Seeing as how she's had cause to criticize my work near on every time she's down here.
Oh, no, she's...
It's all my fault, sir. That's the way she sees it. And I get to blame for the Lord's mistakes as well as my own. If it's not the change in the weather, then it's them moles digging up the north lawn. And if it's not the moles, sir, well...
Yeah, well, then it's... I'll have a word with her when she comes down at the weekend.
Thank you, sir.
Was there something else?
Well, yes, sir, as a matter of fact, there was. You see, the wife and me have been doing some talking. She thinks there's one or two things have been happening in the house that you ought to know about, sir.
What sort of things?
I hope you'll forgive me, sir, but may I speak frankly?
I'd be obliged if you would, Hunt.
Well, sir, it's about Mrs. Barry and Mr. Cannon, sir. They've been down here together.
As I'm well aware of that, Mr. Cannon has my full permission to come down here and work whenever he wants to.
Yes, I know that, sir. What I'm trying to say is that Mrs. Barry has been, well, shall we say, taking certain liberties with her marital vows. If you get my meaning, sir.
Are you trying to tell me that Mrs. Barry and Mr. Cannon have been making love together?
Thank you, sir. That's exactly what I've been trying to tell you. The wife's known about it for a good many months. I knew she had something on her mind, and the other evening I asked her what it was, and she said it was about the way that Mr. Cannon had been carrying on with Mrs. Barry. Then she started pouring the old story out, how she'd gone into Mrs. Barry's bedroom one morning and found...
Thank you, Hunt. There's no need to say any more.
It's the truth, sir.
I dare say. But I don't wish to hear any more. Now, if you'll excuse me.
Yes, sir. Of course, sir. I just would like to say how very sorry we are. The wife and me. Very sorry indeed, sir.
I don't believe you.
It's the truth.
No?
Yes. I'm in love with Gilbert. He's in love with me. We've made love together, not once or twice, but repeatedly over the last 2 years. I'm sorry, Jim. I mean, I'm sorry you had to find out like this. I should have had the courage to tell you myself long ago. But you must have known.
I knew nothing. You're my wife.
In name only. We haven't been married for years. I mean, I tried, Jim. Maybe I didn't try hard enough. I don't know.
The past is the past. If you promise never to see Cannon again, I'll forget it ever happened.
I don't want to forget it. I want a divorce.
A divorce?
Gilbert and I want to get married.
You're twice his age. It's unthinkable.
Not to us.
I won't hear of it!
Why not?
Because you... You're my wife!
That's no answer. You don't love me.
Don't tell me whether I love you or not. I'm telling you I love you.
If you really love me, you'd care a little for my happiness.
Of course I care.
Let me go. Give me a divorce.
Well, I know a divorce means scandal. Think of Cannon if you won't think of me.
Gilbert and I know perfectly well what it would mean. We are prepared to take the consequences.
Well, I'm not. Thinking, Mary. I've been thinking it all over. You're right. You never should have got married. I said that at the time and you wouldn't listen.
I know it's my fault.
No, it's your fault. It's my fault. I knew I never should have got married. I've known that ever since I was old enough to know what marriage was about. I used to have nightmares about it. I used to run in screaming to my mother's room. Tell her I dreamt I got married, but she made her happy to see us together. She thought you'd be good for me. And you thought so too. Thought you could change me. So I knew you couldn't. I couldn't change myself. Did try.
Jimmy, it's not your fault. Nobody's fault.
It was Mary Cannon. He's young, he has talent. He's a man. I'm just a stop clock. Even a clock gets it right twice a day. I've never got it right my whole life.
Nonsense. The most successful writer in England.
Oh, the richest. Cannon's a success. Hasn't got a penny to his name. How's he going to look after him?
Oh, we can manage between us.
You can stop money. I can't stand by. See my wife go without. I see you provide.
We wouldn't dream.
Well, it's the least I can do. Least. Think of the children. I mean, there will be children, won't there?
I hope so.
Well, I must see that they have the best. They must. The best. They must.
Gilbert says he'll have the committee report finished by this afternoon, so I'll bring you back. He He also wanted me to thank you.
Thank me? For what?
Well, for being so understanding.
Give up, Cannon.
What?
I said, give up, Cannon.
Jimmy, we agreed.
We agreed nothing. Please, me. I can't stand the loneliness if you leave me.
You won't be lonely. You've got plenty of friends. You've got Sylvia.
What's Sylvia got to do with it?
She's always meant far more to you than I ever have. You'll still have her. And if we get divorced, I don't see why you and she can't.
Sylvia's a married woman.
Jimmy. Arthur's been dead for over 2 years.
That makes no difference whatsoever. Sylvia's devoted to Arthur, and I'm devoted to her devotion. I would no more think of coming between Sylvia and Arthur than I'd contemplate Cannon coming between us.
Jimmy, I thought...
Harry, I beg of you. Promise that you'll never see Cannon again, and I'll forgive you for everything.
But you understood. I don't want forgiveness. I want to marry Gilbert, and nothing less than a divorce will do.
I will not allow it! All right, run away with him. These mistress, do you like? But I will not grant you a divorce.
I do not intend to be his mistress. I shall be his wife, and there is nothing you can do to stop me.
Please, Mary, please. Oh.
Sorry, Jimmy, I've made up my mind. If you won't grant me a divorce, I shall apply to the court for an annulment.
You can't.
I could always say our marriage has never been consummated.
I thought we'd put the statue over there somewhere. I've given Mr. Frampton some of those old photographs that I took of you dressed up as Peter Pan, so it should bear a striking resemblance to the devil in you.
He's the devil in me.
Especially when you smile.
Do you mind awfully being dwarfed?
I am not a dwarf.
No, I don't mean that. I mean divorced.
Well, perhaps there would be better. That's where that cave where I used to hide things for George.
Don't you love her anymore?
Well, I don't want to talk about her.
You shouldn't smoke so much. It's very addictive.
Who are you?
Not for always, I shan't be. One day, quite soon, I dare say, I shall grow up. And then I'll be like everybody else. And he'll get bored of me and find another boy to love.
Did I get bored of George?
You found me. Perhaps... perhaps if I got bored of you first, that would be amusing, wouldn't it?
Hilarious.
Did Mrs. Barry get bored of you?
I told you I do not want to talk about her.
All right. But don't go and sulk.
I'm not sulking.
Yes, you are. I can always tell. You go all moody. And that's really boring. If you don't step out of it, I shall go home. So you can please yourself.
Yes, ma'am.
Anyway, what cave? You were saying about a cave that you used to hide things for George when he was small.
Oh, an old Solomon's cave leading to the fairy's winter palace.
All I can see are a lot of rabbit holes.
I hope.
Come on, old croc. Let's see if we can get you out for a duck.
I'm sorry, Mummy. I've made up my mind.
I suppose we have to thank Jimmy Barry for this little brainwave.
It was my decision, not his. I'm doing it for my sake as well as the boys. Well, London gets so stuffy in August. I wouldn't dream of letting a little thing like this stand in my way.
But, dear child, you're ill. You can't just...
Ah, I'm ill, am I? At last. Yet you both insist there's nothing whatever to be worried about.
Has the invalid...
Jimmy. Jimmy, will you please persuade Sylvia to abandon this absurd notion of going down into the wilds of Devon for the...
Mummy, I decide what to do. Not Jimmy, not anyone else. Now, that is that. Oh, Jimmy had the sweetest letter from George this morning, saying you'd send him two topping fizzies of Dorothy Dix and Lily Lanky. We also said to tell you, oh, where is it? I had it just a moment ago.
Sylvia, oh, can we not resolve one thing at a time?
There's nothing more to resolve, Mummy. Oh, listen, tell Uncle Jim, I played for the second 11 today and I got 3 wickets, so I'm constantly feeling rather bucked. And then he says, can you send him down another pair of army boots, size 8.5, as he's grown out of the other pair and he needs them for his field day. Also, could you take him down a few tins of ham when you go down on Sunday? Because he claims to be on the verge of starvation. And apparently you know the sort that he likes.
Sylvia?
Yes, Mummy. Oh, listen to this, listen. My newest pair of socks are an absolute poem. Such an exquisite blue, don't you know? And very a la mode. And taken all in all, I think I'm rather a coming chap. Oh, so tell Uncle Jim to beware on Sunday. And I'm absolutely burning for the holiday. For the holidays. Have you talked to Dr. Randall again?
Yes.
What did he say?
Oh, yeah. He said if Sylvia wishes to go to the country, then Sylvia must have what she wishes.
What did the x-ray photographs show him?
Oh, you don't want to take any notice of x-rays. I remember I had my throat x-rayed once. I think it's selling as a picture postcard of the Swiss Alps now.
Jimmy, you're the only one I trust. What did he say?
Nothing.
It's cancer.
No, of course it isn't.
Then why is everyone being so secretive? Why is dear Mummy making such a fuss about my leaving London? Why have I got to have a nurse? Why can't someone just once, Jimmy, just once treat me as an adult? Just tell me what's wrong.
Sylvia, they don't know what's wrong.
Of course they know. Randall knows and Mummy knows. You know. Oh. You know, it seems I'm surrounded by loving friends who are desperately trying to avoid the one word I long to hear. I sat by Arthur's grave the other day, and I whispered it again and again until it sang through my mind. Do you think I'm frightened of dying?
No, not for yourself. Yes. Well, don't I have any decision in the matter?
Come on.
All right.
As I may die now at any time, I would like to set down a few of my wishes. I hope this house will be kept up for the boys, with Mary Hodgson, whom I trust with my whole heart, looking after them. JMB, I know, will do everything in his power to help them, to advise, to comfort, and to sympathize in all their joys and sorrows.
I do not want my Michael to be pressed at all at work. He is not very strong, and his nightmares worry me. But he is sensitive and very intelligent. Great care must be taken with him. Mary Hodgson understands, and of course JMB knows, and will be careful and watch him. I believe that all my boys will become good and brave men, seeing that they are Arthur's sons, and understand how very much they were beloved by him and Sylvia, his altogether faithful and loving wife. I hope for my soul that they will all marry and be tender husbands and have children and live long and happily and be content to be poor if it should be so. I do not wish any of my boys to look at me when I am dead. Let them remember me at my best and when I could look at them. That must have been the best time always, because I love them. So utterly. I should like all my dear ones' love letters to be cremated with me and lie with me and Arthur in the Hampstead churchyard next to beloved Papa. I do not want any of my boys to go to my funeral, nor do I want it to be made into a long and gloomy day for them. One thing I'm certain, that J.M. Barrie will always... that J.M. Barrie, the best friend in the whole world, will always be ready to advise my boys out of his love for...
death. Strange how everyone fears it except the dying. Perhaps this is the secret of the Mona Lisa's smile. Release from the dungeon world. Return to freedom not known since childhood. Child being born as mother dies. Could work this into ghost mother story. They pass each other in their different voyages, the one landing, the other setting sail. And which voyages with the most confidence? The dying or the child? We are never so confident between times. It all seems so easy at the beginning and the end.
Tosh, we just thought we'd go off and do a spot of fishing down by the mill. See if we can't catch that old bull trout we saw yesterday.
Jack and Nico are going with you.
Nico's up there with the farmer's son.
Oh, and Jack's out playing with the farmer's daughter.
I always knew Jack had an adventurous spirit. You see, it's something they obviously don't encourage at Eton.
Oh, indeed they do, Mother. But they also teach us good taste. Have you seen her? I'd sooner catch trout any day.
I remember how Michael once danced at chapel bell tolling the funeral of another child.
Goodbye, Mother.
Bye, darling.
Bye, Uncle Jim.
Bye, Peter. Have a good day.
Come on, Michael.
Aren't you going with them, Michael? What's the matter? Come on. Tell me, what
is it? What's the matter? Oh. There's nothing to be frightened of. I'll be well soon.
You promise?
I promise.
Don't say goodbye like that. Let me see my Michael smile. That's better. Off you go. Off you go. Go on. Jimmy, can you pass my mirror? Don't let my boys see me again.
As they are.
Of course they are.
The biggest, well,
of course.
Come on.
That's okay. The younger brother.
There's a small one.
Six.
Of course. Right. You're ready?
Yeah.
The style. Now, hold it in for about, you know, about 5 seconds or so.
KB!
Bugger it!
What's this? This ring.
It's an engagement ring, Jack. I gave it to your mother to try to understand.
I understand, all right. Congratulations, Uncle Jim. Now you've finally got us where you want us.